Welcome back to the next session in Module 4, Program of Logic Controllers. In the last session, you people have come across introduction regarding about programmable logic controllers. There, how to program the ladder diagram and the concept related to ladder diagram, latching concept, and some of the selection criteria that are get involved in selecting the best PLC, that is nothing but programmable logic controller. In the next bit of the syllabus, we are moving towards the introduction towards the actuators, and there are different types of actuators that are commonly come across in many of the industries. And the next thing is about robots and how the industrial robot, what is the definition of industrial robot, and some different parts of a robot, and robot controller, drive system that are used in the robot, and different types of arms and the end effectors, and last regarding about the sensors and functional requirement of a robot that is necessarily required in many of the applications. In today's session, let us know about few of the things regarding about what is an actuator, how the actuator will going to work, and different types of actuators and advanced actuators. How they are moving towards the advanced actuators, why advanced actuator is necessarily required for us. And next thing is about the industrial robot and their industrial robot definition and different parts of a robot controller. Okay, these are the topics I am going to cover in today's session. Now, the first thing is about the actuators. Even in a Module 4, the electrical actuation, mechanical actuation system, you people have come across the term that is nothing but the actuators. What is an actuator? Why the actuator is used? We have already completed that module, but even though they are given, they have included the same thing in this module 3 itself, that is nothing but the programmer logic controller. When it's come to the actuator is a device which make something to move or to operate. Is a device which make something to move or to operate. How this actuator is moving something, whether it is an object or some other material or some other operations or some other working condition, whatever it may be, how it is getting moved, that is one of the major thing. Means actuator means it is moving something or it is operating something. In our daily life, we have come across a lot of actuators. In our daily life, we are going to use a lot of actuators. When it's come to the applications, if you are once after entering the car, while adjusting the seat of the car, you can observe that their actuator will be there. You people are adjusting the seat of the car. That is one kind of actuator present over there. Their linear movement is possible. Next, automatic door opening and closing applications in any of the malls, in any of the office, you can clearly observe that once after the presence of an object or then a person who is standing in front of the door, with help of the sensor, the door will get opened. Once after entering, the door will automatically closed. Even in buses, you can observe it. There are different kinds of linear actuators they are used. And similarly, in many of the applications in our daily life, we come across lot of actuators. There you can observe that it will going to move something or it will going to operate something. That is one of the major thing we come across. We have seen that. How it is performed means for that movement, what is the necessary thing that is clearly required for us. For example, if I am moving my arm from ear to ear, some linkages are there, the flow of fluid is flow of blood is circulating throughout my body, with some static loading or unloading or whatever it may be, whether load conditions are a dynamic loading, whatever it may be, free movement is happening. Without any load, I am moving my hand. Means here some kind of energy is transferred. In similar fashion, when it's come to the actuator, there also the source of energy that is really required to move that object or to operate any kinds of, or to operate means to move that object or to operate any of the material, that for that movement the energy source that is necessarily required, that energy sources are nothing but when it's come to the actuators, hydraulic means if you are using the fluid, when it's come to the fluid, we are going to consider the fluid into two types. One is air, another one is the oil or water or liquid. These are comes under liquid. It's nothing but fluid. There, in when it's come to the fluid medium, if you are using hydraulic oil or water, it is an hydraulic actuator. If you are using compressed air, it is pneumatic actuators. If you are using electrical power supply to actuate the things, it is electrical actuator. If you are using thermal actuator, means if you are using heat as a source of energy, that is thermal actuator. In similar fashion, when it's come to the mechanical actuators, in mechanical actuators, there some physical work should be applied or some load should be applied on the one metal which get contact with the another metal, due to which that physical movement will go into happen. That is mechanical actuators. There, in mechanical actuators, in module 4, you come across lot of mechanical actuation system, gears, cams, etc., etc. You people know lot of mechanical actuators. Their linear movement or rotary movement is get converted to some other form. Okay, these based on sources of energy, they will going to classify the actuators in different times. If I generally classify the actuators, actually the actuators are classified into only two types, that is nothing but linear actuators and rotary actuators. When it's come to the linear actuators are the actuators which going to give the linear movement, means only the linear displacement is going to happen. Those are all linear actuators. Rotary actuators are the actuators, it will going to utilize the source of energy, then it will going to provide the motion in terms of mechanical torque or mechanical rotations, that is rotary actuators. Even though I can do the classification based on the linear actuators and also on the rotary actuators. Linear actuators may be cylinders, single piston and cylinder arrangement. It is also called as single acting cylinder, double acting cylinder, through cylinder. There are different kinds of cylinder which will going to create only the linear motion. And also in some of the mechanical devices and some of the mechanical devices which we are going to use in today's life, there also linear movement is also possible. By rotary motion, linear movement is possible. By linear motion, rotary motion is also possible. Okay, people have come across a lot of things. Similar fashion, when it's come to the rotary actuators are the actuators which will going to create the rotational motions. For that, very good example is nothing but the motors. Means in motors, you people have come across gear motors, vane motors, piston motors, lot of motors you people have studied in our fluid power system and also fluid power engineering. Lot of actuators will come to the picture. Means based on rotational movement, different motors will be there. In similar fashion, the classification can be broadly of actuators can be broadly expand based on the usage and based on the requirement what we people have observed in today's life. This is the major things regarding about the actuators. Next, I'll move on to the types of actuators. Here I've written the some of the basic five types of actuators, that is nothing but mechanical actuators, electrical actuators, hydraulic actuators, pneumatic actuators, thermal actuators. Means these type of actuators what I have written, this purely based on types of energy source that are clearly we people are using. Means based on type of energy sources what we are using, based on that I have written it. If I go for some other types, the linear thing and rotary things will come to us, that purely depends on how they will going to perform. Now let us know about the first one, that is mechanical actuators. This is the diagram I have written, that is simple as screw jack arrangement, as nothing but a jack I have written here for the mechanical actuators. Based on type of motion, it will going to create. Even in your mechanical actuation system in module 4, you people come across different types of cams, different types of gears, and rack and pinion arrangement, ratchet and pole mechanisms. You people have come across lot of types of motions you people have come across over there. They're all mechanical actuation systems. This was one of the type of mechanical actuation system. Here we'll going to rotate this lever, whatever present here, due to which it will get the deformation and expansion. Means here, the due to rotation of it, it will get compressed, due to which the whatever the linkages they have get supported over it, it will get it to come to the vertical position by to the, as by the, you can observe the deflections, it will going to get deformed, will be like this. Once after the compression of the spring, due to which the vertical movement will going to happen. The base is the supporting structure. For that, one link, two link, and four links were present. For that four links, two joints were present, where that spring will going to operate. Means once after rotating it, the vertical movement will going to happen. Means if the rotation is clockwise, the vertical movement will going to happen. If the rotation is clockwise, anti-clockwise, the downward movement will going to operate. Happen. Means these kinds of mechanical actuators are used for lifting the cars, for replacing the wheels and some other purposes. This is one of the example I have taken to explain the mechanical actuators. In similarly, you can go for other diagrams in mechanical actuators, whether it is the cams or gears or rack and pinion arrangement, ratchet and pole mechanisms, whichever it may be, it is left to you. Next is about the electrical actuators. For electrical actuators also, one of the best example is DC motor, AC motors, stepper motors. You can write any of the diagrams. For simplification, I have written this simple basic structure of a DC motor. You can observe the two coils present over there. This is the shaft get connected. When the voltage is applied, the rotor will going to rotate, due to which the magnetic flux is get induced. Based on the magnetic flux get induced, the shaft will going to rotate. That is get connected to the some other devices. And one more thing here, in mechanical actuators, here the one form of energy is get converted into another form. Here mechanical energy is get converted to mechanical energy itself. But the change of motion happenings in different types. Here rotational motion is get converted into linear motion. In when it's come to the actuators, actuators will going to receive an input in some other forms, but it will going to convert the output in only in form of a mechanical torque or mechanical displacement or whatever it means. Only the displacement will going to happen, only the rotation will going to happen. That is about the actuators. Here the electrical actuators, it will going to use the electrical energy. That electrical energy is get converted into the rotations. That is nothing but the torque rotations. This is about the electrical actuators. When it's come to the hydraulic actuators, you people have studied about the simple basic diagram of hydraulic system. In hydraulic actuators, there are few of the things that are necessarily required in hydraulic actuators. Here, the source of energy we are using is nothing but the oil or the water. But to perform the motions or to get the linear displacement in the single acting cylinder or double acting cylinder, we require lot of other devices to get connected it to perform in a smooth manner. For that, I written the diagram of the hydraulic actuator. Even though the whatever the parts present over here, that is not the pump, motor, flow control valve, filter, pressure control valve, direction control valve, these things are remain same for the pneumatic controls, pneumatic actuators. For that, I have not written the diagram for pneumatic actuators. When it's come to the pneumatic actuators, will going to use the compressed air. That is nothing but there, instead of the pump and the motor, they will go for using the compressor. And one more very good important device, that is nothing but the accumulator, they will going to use over there. Instead of tank, instead of pump and motor, they will going to use the compressed air and the accumulator. And other things remains will going to same for pneumatic actuators. Okay, now hydraulic actuator I am explaining. In hydraulic actuator, we will going to use oil or water to get the displacement of the piston. Here I have written the diagram of its tank is necessarily required for the hydraulic fluid, and the filter to purify the contaminants that are present in the fluid, and flow control valve. This flow control valve is in a valve which will going to control the flow, whether it is in controlling the flow rate in one direction or in other directions, because one directional valve will also will be there, bidirectional valve will also will be there. Flow control valves used to control the speed of the flow of fluid that is going to happen in the hydraulic system, that is flow control valve. Through that flow control valve, it is get connected to the pump. Pump is get actuated by the motor. Again, here energy conversion will going to happen. Again, that hydraulic energy is transferred to the pressure control valves. In pressure control valve, these kinds of pressure control valves are used to compensate the pressure of the fluid that is passing to the cylinder. Means if high pressure get enters, it will going to damage the parts or the linkages that are present over there, due to which we are using the pressure control valve or to compensate the pressure by fixing the pressure to the required level with the help of the indicator or with the help of some other type of the gauges. This is pressure control valve. That after that pressure control valve is get connected to directional control valve. Here in the directional control valve, whether it is a 2x4 or 3x2 based on position and the ports that are available in the directional control valve, we'll go for naming it. Direction control valve will going to give the motion to the it will going to give the direction for the fluid that is present inside the system. Where in some of the cases they will going to use the lever, in some of the cases they will go for the push button type, in some of the cases solenoid operated, in some of the cases spring return type of direction control valve. There are a lot of applications were there. Means if I use the your push button over there, once operating the push button, the cylinder will going to get extended. Again, to come back to its initial position, again I need to go to operating the push button. Again, it will get retract back to its original position. Means here the flow movement of the cylinder is controlled with the help of the directional control valve. This is the example of an hydraulic actuator. And similarly, the pneumatic actuators will going to work, but we need to use the compressor and the accumulator here. That is the regarding about the hydraulic actuator and pneumatic actuators. Next thing is about the thermal actuators. When it's come to the thermal actuators, for thermal actuators we are using the bimetallic strips. That is nothing but the two different type of materials are used. For those two different types of materials, when I supply the electrical supply, how the material will going to deflect and make a contact. For this, very good example is an electrical switch. There you can observe it. We will going to call the electrical switch into two types, NO and NC. NC stands for normally closed, NO stands for normally open switch. It's nothing but once after pressing the switch, the power supply is get on by making the contact of two different connections or two different linkages. In similar fashion, it will going to work. Here the base part is get bolted with the two bimetallic strips. Once before the electrical supply, the metallic object will be like this. Once after supplying the electrical power supply, the heat is get induced in the bimetallic strip, due to which it will get deflected and make the contact of the electrical contact and that power supply. Means here also the energy transformation is going to happen. Electrical energy to heat energy, heat energy again to electrical energy. This is regarding about the thermal actuators. Means with help of temperature variations, it will going to work. And next about the advanced actuators. Why these advanced actuators are necessarily required? Why they are moving towards this advanced actuator? What is the purpose of it? That is one of the major things that is necessarily required for us. Because you people have studied lot of things regarding about different types of actuators. There some of the disadvantages you people are notified in very commonly and regularly in many of the actuators. And that they have concentrated most towards reduced size of the actuators, reduce the mass of the actuators, power consumption and the cost. These are the four things they have concentrated to get approved or get improved in the advanced actuators. Means by taking the disadvantages of many of the actuators they have come across, these are the drawbacks we need to overcome to get the performance of the actuators in very good manner. When it's come to that, in hydraulic actuators the weight of the actuator is more, and the space floor space utilizing of that hydraulic actuators will be more in hydraulic actuators. In mechanical actuators, lot of connections will be there, due to which the moment as we keep on using that linkages, the linkages we are using that as a material, some elastic properties of the material will get increased, due to which the performance will get weak. And when it's come to the pneumatic system, again there the amount of force that is necessarily required for us is not achieved, but somehow it is rarely used for the lifting the light objects. In when it's come to the thermal objects, even though we are using the bimetallic strips over there, the material properties will change as we can as using that bimetallic strip for the long duration. Means they have studied lot of things over there. To overcome these issues, they will go for reducing the waste, size of the actuator, mass and power consumption and the cost. For that, there are lot of research is going on now. Even today, even from the past few years, there are lot of research is going on. How they are doing it? I have concentrated only on two things. By using the shape memory alloy and the electro-rheological fluids, they are overcoming it. And by using the shape memory alloys. And also one more thing, before going to the shape memory alloys, let us know about how they are going to reducing the side. But they will keep on studying and doing the research on smart materials. They are keep on studying about the smart. There, the strength of the material will be same compared to the whatever the materials they are already used in many of the actuators. But the weight of that those materials will keep on changing by using some composite materials, some using smart materials over there. This research, when they have made these kinds of features, they are only concentrated only on these four parameters. Based on that, they have come across about the shape memory alloy, how this shape memory alloy will going to work. Means here, in shape memory alloy, it consists of a group of metallic material that demonstrate the ability to return to some previously defined shape or size when subjected to the appropriate thermal procedure. Means here we are clearly saying that shape memory alloy works on this principle. Group of metallic materials are present there to demonstrate the ability of the ability to return to some previously defined shape or size. It means once after the deformation is on happened in any of the material in this shape memory alloy, again that material will come back to its original shape by applying the load or whatever it may be. But they are saying that when you are applying the thermal or the heat content to it, again it will be back to its original shape. Means by using shape memory alloys, they will go for they can reduce the weight and mass of that particular actuator. Next thing about the electro-rheological fluids, they are not only concentrated on the material they will going to use in the actuators, they also concentrated on, in some of the cases, the energy medium, that is nothing but the fluid, is also creating lot of issues because it will going to change its properties. When it's come to the properties, the first thing in the fluid is nothing but the viscosity. When it's come to the viscosity problems in hydraulic actuators, we can observe that as the weather is gets changed, the viscosity is also getting changed. To overcome these issues, they will go for electro-rheological fluids. In that, the fluid that experience dramatic changes in rheological properties such as viscosity in the presence of an electrical field. Because means the electro-rheological fluids works on this principle of operations that in nothing but it will going to change its properties, that is nothing but the rheological properties. Viscosity, that property is nothing but viscosity in the presence of electric field. Once after the applying the electrical field, the properties of that particular fluid is getting changed. By to get the advanced actuators in a very good in a smooth manner and to get the very good performance of that those advanced actuators are improvising the actuators to that level, they are doing a lot of research on these areas because they are moving towards the smart materials and they are moving towards some fluids that are necessarily required for the longer duration of time. This is about the how the research is moving towards the advanced actuators and how the conventional actuators is differ from the advanced actuators. It's nothing but they are taken the some of the drawbacks that are available in conventional actuators, that is nothing but hydraulic, pneumatic and electrical actuators. They are overcoming these actuators with the help of using different smart materials and different types of fluids. That is regarding about the advanced actuators. Next thing I have written, that next topic is about the industrial robot. Even in your last semester, fifth semester, you people have come across to the industrial robot and the automation topics. You people have studied over that. But even though in your syllabus I have included it, but the one of the basic thing you people have come across about the robot means the forced labor. Means the labor which will going to work for more than an hour or 24 hours or whatever it may be for a longer duration of time, but without any rest, we can perform the repetitive work for more duration of time with better performance. That is about the industrial robot. Here I have written the definition of an industrial robot. An industrial robot is a reprogrammable, multifunctional manipulator designed to move material, parts, tools or some special devices through variable programmed motions for the performance of a variety of tasks. This is the definition of an industrial robot. Means it is a multifunctional reprogrammable manipulator. Means if I designed a robot, robot is not set for only one type of operation. It can perform different types of operations. Means for that they are given the term multifunctional manipulator. It will going to manipulate it. Multifunctional manipulator. And one more thing, they are going to reprogrammable. For doing different types of tasks, I should program that robot. I should teach that robot for doing different kinds of task. That's why it's a reprogrammable multifunctional manipulator designed to move materials. It is moving the material, it is moving some parts, it is moving some tools or some special devices through variable programmed motions. Means through that program it is doing that. We are saying that reprogrammable, we can teach it for different types to perform different type of tasks. How we are teaching it? Through variable programmed. Means we are creating variable program motions over there through which that program it will going to perform the motions for the performance of a variety of tasks. That is about the definition of an industrial robot. Means we are replacing the human worker in some of the hazardous environment. There the robot is used to perform some repetitive tasks for longer duration of time. We are using the robot, and also for lifting the heavy loads, that these type things are very difficult for an human worker. Means wherever we are finding difficulty for in the human worker, for the human worker in many of the applications, there the robots are used. That is about the industrial robot. Next topic is about different parts of a robot controller. Means what are the parts that are present for a robot controller? Here I have written the one of the basic structure that is generally used for the explanation purpose about the robot. This is the first type of the thing what we will going to explain for many of the students. This is the basic structure for a robot. Means the base part should be there, rigid base part should be there. So that base part, one linkage should be there. For that connect, one more linkage joint should be there. Again, one more link we have provided, again one more joint is there, again one more link is there. Means by using different kinds of links, in the next class you people are going to study a lot of things about the types of joints and links that are available, that are present in the robot applications. Means for a robot, for example, if I use my arm as a robot arm, you can clearly observe here, this is the base part. This shoulder to ear, one link will be there, again one joint is there, again to shoulder to the my body, one more joint is there, again from my forearm to ear, one more joint and the link is present, again to wrist part, this called as an end effector, that is nothing but the end of the arm, one more joint is present over there. Means to connect for the different do the different types of tasks, we are going to use the end effector, different kinds of end effectors, but a rigid structure is very much important. Base part, the links and the joints. These are the different parts of a robot controller. With the help of this, they will going to perform different types of tasks. In the next class, you people will come across the types of joints and linkages and the drive system that are necessarily used in robotics. This is regarding about the today's session. Thank you.